So while Rogelio is getting ready, I'm going to read his bio, which is quite impressive. I'm very honored that he is here with us today, and I'm pretty sure you will find very, you will be astonished in terms of what he's going to talk about, and you will find it very interesting. So Rogelio Lozano holds a Bachelor of Communication and Electronics from IPN, Instituto Politécnico Nacional, in Mexico. He obtained a Master in Electrical Engineering from the Research and Advanced Studies Center, SINVESTAD, of Instituto Politécnico Nacional. A Master in Control and a PhD in Automatic Control from LAG in Grenoble. He has held several appointments, professor at SINVESTAD, visiting professor at the University of Newcastle, Australia, researcher at NASA, Langley Research Center in the United States, visiting professor at LAG in Grenoble. And to date, he is the head of UMI, LAFMIA, which is a French-Mexican laboratory in SINVESTAD. So Professor Lozano has participated in two international UAV competitions organized by ONERA and DGA in the periods of 2003 and 2005, and 2007 to 2009. And he has coordinated three UAV projects for the Picardy region in France in the period from 1999 to 2011. He is the coordinator of a project on vertical takeoff and landing planes funded by DGA. And this happened from 2006 to 2007. And he has participated on UAV navigation, on projects on UAV navigation using optical flow funded by the FRIAE. And that happens from 2007 to 2011. So he has been coordinated, a coordinator of several projects of this type. And his main interests include adaptive control and identification, dissipative dynamical systems, control of underactuated mechanical and nonlinear systems, modeling and control of mini aerial vehicles. And Professor Lozano was also an associate editor of Automatica from 1987 to 2000. So currently, he serves as editor of the International Journal of Adaptive Control and Signal Processing since 1993. So he has worked on these areas, and he has led to 22 PhD students, successful PhD students. He has published over 90 journal papers, 160 conference papers, 4 Springer books, and 5 edited books. So as you can see, we're very happy he's here. So thank you, Rogelio. So go ahead.
Well, sorry for that long bio. thank you, Jose, for inviting us to be in this meeting. This is my first time in Hawaii, and I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very happy to see all these people interested in UAVs. So my presentation is going to, I always like to start with some history. Sometimes you learn looking at history. Takes time. Well, I'll just show you some slides on history. And this is, as you know, although somebody told me that he was not perhaps the first to invent things that fly, because you also have this little toy that you start with your hands and turns around. But this, as you know, this is Leonardo da Vinci in Italy. Known to be the first that invented this concept, although he never saw anything flying like this. Some of the parts in history, there used to be competition, as Jose was mentioning today, there's many competitions. This was in the beginning in 1901, and I use this because I gave this talk in Brazil, so, and this guy is from Brazil, Alberto Santos Dumont, and actually the Rio de Janeiro's airport has his name. He won this prize because he was the first to turn, use, but at that time they were using blimps or lighter than air to go around the Eiffel Tower. And of course, you know, the Wright flyer, I mean the Wright brothers. When you look at into this, I mean, of course, I looked as you all do in Google, it's not so clear when really. I mean, these are photos that are not so, but they are supposed to be the first that flew something that was not a blimp. And when this the same guy from Brazil flew this plane in 1907. Now, let us just about helicopters. I mean, helicopters. I think this is rather the beginning. You see a French guy. This is the photo. That he's supposed to be inside that big aircraft. It was like he had two rudders, and apparently he flew some meters above the ground. As you can see, there was a combustion machine. Now, this is something interesting because some of you might have heard that the Spanish guy Juan de la Cierva was the first, some people call him like the father of the helicopters. In fact, reading at the history of this Juan de la Cierva, you will learn that he was not interested in helicopters. He was rather interested in airplanes, but he wanted to fly he wanted to avoid wings. You see, this airplane doesn't have a wing, so he wanted to have something that turns around. And actually, he made lots of attempts to fly this thing, but he always had the problem that once he took off, the plane went to one of the sides and crashed. Then he discovered that the thing was that the blades coming, I mean, the blades were turning, and when there was a difference between the blade coming forward was receiving more, the air, the lifting was higher because the air coming in was higher, and so there was a difference between the blades coming in, going back or going forward. So he invented the cyclic control. Okay, so later the cyclic control turned out to be very important for helicopters, and that's why some people say that he was very important for helicopters. Now there was this Argentinian, perhaps, he went to Paris, and I think they all have very interesting stories, histories. He was a lawyer or something, nothing to do with engineering, but he was one of the first. I mean, what he invented was this aircraft having counter-rotating rotors, several, to increase the lift. And he was using the cyclic control invented by Juan de la Cierva. This is perhaps the oldest quadrotor that I found in the history. That's why I wanted to show it to you. So there was one quadrotor very long time ago, and after that. People, kind of forgot about quadrotors. They, mainly because this guy, Igor Sikorsky, because he took all the ideas from Juan de la Sierra, etc., and came up with the first fully controllable helicopter. Some people say that he didn't invent helicopters. However, he was the first to put, I mean, he used the cyclic control from Juan de la Sierra, and he introduced an additional control, which is the, the altitude control for the blades. And so he used the previously invented cyclic control from Juan de la Sierra, but he introduced also the tail rotor. And he was also the first to make a helicopter in series and he did that for the Second World War. Okay, and that's why people forgot about quad rotors for quite a long time, because he invented this very successful machine. So never people thought that quad rotors didn't have a future, I would say. So let me go back just to that we understand what we're talking about. This is just a photo, some diagrams of what is called a swashplate. Perhaps you don't know much about this because you all work on quad rotors, perhaps, and quad rotors don't have a swashplate. And that is actually one of the main features of quad rotors. They don't have this mechanism, which is expensive, heavy, etc. Although I think it's very important, so it's good to mention it. So a swashplate is that thing that you see above, and it has this collective pitch together with the cyclic control. So the cyclic control allows you, in a helicopter, allows you to have the pitch torque and the roll torque, which is very important for control. Okay. It's also, I mean, I have to say that if instead of playing with, I used to play with classic, very small helicopters, and it's a nuisance, I mean, as compared to quad rotors, because it is very, as Jose was saying, you crash very often. When you crash a quad rotor, you can repair it very quickly. You can just change the blades, basically. But in a classic control, the rotor is larger. It can hurt people. If you go to internet, you will unfortunately find that there's even been people that have been killed because they have been hit by small helicopters. But besides that, when it crashes, to repair a helicopter, it takes more and more time. You have to. I mean, the main rotor, the main axis always bends a little bit, and you cannot fly if it is bended. All these mechanisms you have to check again. I started working on UAVs in 1997, and the first thing I did, because following some of the universities working on the subject at that time, I bought a almost 2 meter diameter helicopter. It is still a Vario. It's a German, very combustion engine, 25 cubic centimeters. It's like 10 kilograms. I thought that was the right way to go. That helicopter is still sitting somewhere close to my office, somewhere close to my desk, covered with a sheet. We after some flights, we discovered that it was very, I mean, at that time, quad rotors have not really, they were starting. We bought a quad rotor just perhaps a few months after we bought this large helicopter. The thing is that when you want to fly a combustion engine helicopter, even an electric helicopter, you have to verify many things before flying. It took me, well, first of all, before flying, it took me like a half an hour checking all the knobs, all the screws, tie, I mean, to make sure that everything was fine in the helicopter. And I only managed to fly by myself on top of a platform. You have platforms to fly these helicopters. You can fly it outside. I mean, a friend of mine who could fly this helicopter, was able to fly it. It was also the one that helped me putting this helicopter together. It took us like, we used to work on weekends. It took us like 4 or 5 Saturdays, full Saturdays. So this is not the case with quadrotors. So you can fly, I mean, you can put a quadrotor in just 1 or 2 hours. So that's perhaps why helicopters are not so much used. Okay, what else I wanted to say? Just to make sure that you know, I mean, this is just a gyro, and as you know, when this mass is turning, you have what is called the conservation of angular momentum. That is important to know, because that's perhaps one very interesting difference between a classical helicopter and a quadrotor. A quadrotor basically doesn't have this, I mean, you have 4 rotors turning, so they obviously they have angular momentum, but unfortunately you have 2 motors turning clockwise, and the other two motors are turning on the opposite direction. So basically the angular momentum cancels. So what's the problem? Well, the problem is that with a classical helicopter, this guy managed to fly this helicopter actually because this angular momentum is there, you see, because this guy was, I mean, I'm sure he was taking care of just the jaw, and the angular momentum is such that a little bit of wind will not move too much the helicopter. You see, it has some robustness with respect to wind gust, which is not necessarily the case for a quadrotor, and that explains why. In a quadrotor, you have to introduce 3 gyros. In a classical helicopter, you only need 1 gyro. And that gyro is used to control the jaw, okay? This is just an explanation of the gyroscopic phenomena that is important every time you have a rotor that is turning. Just to make sure, this is just the scheme of a wing, and a pointer. And then, so you have the lift and the drag. The lift. I mean, if this is so, this is the relative wind, and orthogonal to the relative wind, you always have the lift and the drag. It's in the same direction, opposite direction to the relative wind. And this is the center pressure. Okay. Well, so I know 2 other things. I mean, in a helicopter, you have the ground effect, when the helicopter is flying or the quadrotor is flying close to the ground. Okay, this is when it's far from the earth. This is when it is very close. Okay. Now, this is perhaps one of the most important differences between the classical helicopter and the quadrotors. A helicopter in an emergency landing, you can use the auto-rotation. I mean, if the tail rotor fails for some reason, you have to stop the motor, you have to, and then if the helicopter is high enough, you can drop the helicopter, and with the wind, you can make things in such a way that the wind turns. I mean, you have to change the pitch angle of the blades, and so the wind going through the blades will make them turn turn more and more, and that energy will be used just before landing. So just before landing, you have to again change the pitch of the blades so that you blow air downwards, and then you can land more or less safely. And this is this landing like this. I mean, of course, this is only very expert pilots can do it. But that safety is very important in helicopters, which we still don't have this type of things in quadrotors. Perhaps one day people will introduce this in quadrotors, and I'm sure it will help to, I mean, so that you can fly in urban areas or things like that. Just we will soon start. I mean, we will soon. I just found this other photo from just at the end of the Second World War. So this is another kind of portable helicopter. But the interesting thing is that these blades were driven by rotors that were mounted on the blades themselves. And there are some, what I mean is that there are some helicopters that are trying to avoid having a tail rotor, which sometimes makes problem. So this is one attempt as early as 1944. And there are other ways, like there's other helicopters that use the air pressure, like and they blow the air on up to the tail or the tip of the blades to make the rotors turn. Okay, just to tell you, and this is actually a toy that is based on that phenomena. So you have just six blades, and these blue blades have rotors. You can. This is a toy that is not very well known. I just show it to you, and it costs just $20. So, very interesting, because the thing is that when you use the rotor, the motors on the blades, you're certainly saving some things, like you're saving the gear, transmission gears from the motor to the blades, actually, I'm sure you can increase the flying time, which can be interesting. But but unfortunately, this toy doesn't have a swashplate, because everything turns. So perhaps there's some projects to improve this toy. And actually, this is the last history photo. This guy managed with just air pressure to lift from the earth, but it was a long time ago, 1952. Okay, so just to as a resume, as I was telling you, you can fly a helicopter with just one gyro, while a quadrotor needs three gyros. Of course, a quadrotor is mechanically simpler, and you can repair it more easily. A helicopter has a swashplate, a freewheeling unit, etc. So it's more complicated. That is why quadrotors have been developed. I mean, that is why you find quadrotors in many universities today. However, a helicopter is more efficient and has larger autonomy. And a helicopter can perform auto rotation. Okay, now this is just a chart. Some of you know. I mean, there are drones of many different sizes. In our lab, for security reasons, we restrict ourselves to have small quadrotors, small blades, just for security, because we haven't had that many accidents, so fortunately, but I think it's good to pay attention to. I mean here you work with very small UAVs, and I think that's a good idea. As soon as you start working with larger and larger UAVs, you have to be more careful. One thing that, as Jose was saying, I participated to some meetings some years ago in France, and actually it was compulsory that if you wanted to participate in these meetings, you had to make sure that you have an emergency procedure, an emergency landing procedure. So what they used to make us, it was they asked us to turn the drone on, and then all of a sudden they say, well, turn the radio off. And then we had to turn the radio off, and the helicopter had to reduce the speed slowly, so that it will land safely in a few seconds. So this is what is called emergency landing procedure. I have had students that have not used this emergency landing procedure, and it has happened that some people went to see them because we usually fly in the football court that we have in Silvestal, and it has happened that some professors have been going to check these students, and they ask him, where is your drone? And they say, well, they just pointed to the sky and say, you see that little dot? That's my drone. What happened? I don't know. I'm trying to make it down. It doesn't respond. We have lost several drones like that. That is not the biggest problem. The biggest problem is what happens if that lands on somebody else's head. So that's why if you try to fly larger UAVs, think about emergency landing procedures. Okay, what else should I? These are commercial. Yeah, you know this thing. This was the team. This was our team back in 2004. In one of the that was the type of things of drones that we used to fly. At that time, well, things were not, the drones were not so intelligent. This was the helicopter I was telling you about. This is 1997. It's still there, but it's kind of dangerous for us. These were our first experiments with vision and a helicopter. This was one quad rotor. This is back in 2007. It was our first autonomous flight, because it was using ultrasonic sensors. This is just a friend of us in Sydney. This is a tail seater. It's a VTOL, a vertical takeoff and landing. It's larger than it looks in the photo, because the blades are like this. So very large. But he's no longer in the university. I mean, the guy Houston is somewhere in an aircraft company in Sydney. But he was able to. And this is a prototype that is kind of motivated by the other one. We had several prototypes concerning beetles. We had some experience like this one with just one single rotor. This was a glider. This is a very, very, very simple to build. Amazingly, this if you put some reinforcements in the places where it should be, this thing can fly and can stand a lot of wind, more than you can think, and it's very inexpensive. Okay, maybe. Well, this was we worked on a project. This was an A&R project. We were supposed to, as in the title, this is a gun-launched UAV. The problem was there were some guys from the police that wanted wanted us to develop a UAV that can. They had the following problem. They told us, let's assume that we are 500 meters away from a prison, and there is a riot, and we want we're going to intervene to control the people, the prisoners, but we want to minimize casualties. So we want to see just before the attack. We want to see what is really going on in the prison. So we need a UAV, but the present UAV at that time, and I think it's still the case, the quadrotors will not go 500 meters. I don't, well, or at least not easily. They will use all the battery to go to the place, and they wanted something that will. They wanted a UAV that will go there, send images, and come back. So since we were working with people that are very expert on explosives, so they wanted us to develop something that could be thrown from a cannon and then be deployed just on top of above the prison and then come back. So we spent 3 years. So we developed partly the project, but the project was not concluded. Okay. So and this thing was developed at that time, and it has to and the UAV had to be such that it could be deformed in the shape of a missile. So we had some experience about it. This is just a list of students that I have had. I will go quickly. These are some books on this. On manned aerial vehicles. And this is just a photo of this is the Yumi in Mexico City in Silverstar. And then photos that you can take from using UAVs. I forgot to say that Sergio, who's also he's from Guamantla, and they have this Guamantlada, which is a party where they have bulls, and so they took the drone there to take photos. Okay, so maybe time is running, so I would like to present something else. Maybe I should present videos. This is work. This is the work of one student. Okay, this is so the first. The guy in the video is Diego. He's now in a postdoc somewhere in the United States. But this is he was working on one of these rooms with cameras. Okay, this is more recent work. He has a quadrotor, a parrot, and this is in this work. This is his PhD in Compiègne, France. So the thing is that here the quadrotor is not using the cameras in the room. He's using only his camera. Here, as you can see, he's finding the characteristic points in the scene, and then from there he's generating a trajectory. So he was able to make circles, and also to go up and down. So we just to say, he only wanted to use one camera to fly using the characteristic points from the scene. So in these movements, as I was telling you, he's not using, the important thing is that he's not using the cameras around, just a single camera, or perhaps two, perhaps the other one pointing downwards. Okay. He worked on using rows, and I think he was very motivated by some works in Munich University, as I remember. He published this in conferences, so far not in journals, unfortunately. I wanted to show you also. Well, let me see. This is the work of another PhD student who just finished. Let's see if I can make it run. Just a different type of thing. Actually, Diego was also part of this work. This student, what they worked on using quadrotors to be able to handle a load that is hanging with a rope. So they developed some strategy based on energy, and they used some Hamiltonian theory. And so they moved this helicopter from one point to another, and as you can see, they suppressed the swings. This is going to appear in this journal of intelligent robotics. So, and it's based, as I was saying, into passivity-based controllers and these type of things. She just finished her PhD in Cuernavaca, but she stayed two years in Compiègne with the CONACYT scholarship. Okay. Okay, I will first show this video. Ivan is he's got a cathedra from CONACYT this year. First of all, they worked on controlling the altitude. So here is the football court I was telling you about. All our videos there, you'll see the Chiquiguita Hill behind. And as you can see, he's only moving the pitch and roll movements. And the altitude is being controlled with a sensor, a laser sensor. That works in with the grass or they just gave me these videos not long ago. They didn't explain me everything, but they just told me that and later on I will show you a video with using a GPS, an RTK GPS. But here is not, they are only using, they are manually controlling pitch and roll, but the altitude is being controlled using a sensor. It is this laser altitude sensor. Okay. Let me show you the other one. This RTK. Differential GPS. $1,000 for those who want to buy it. I'm not selling it. But, and so they, of course, they have used the standard GPS that you can buy for $150 or $200. With this one, you can get more precision. For some reason, they took a lot of time to get this GPS, I mean, this prototype moving correctly. I'm sure there are some tricks with this RTK GPS. It takes some time, and apparently, well, they have many problems, but of course, I'm showing you the best video that they got. So, as you can see, it's very stable, more than with a normal or standard GPS. And so they use also, they generated just a square trajectory. And as you can see, there's even people moving too close to the quadrotor. He's working, he's not by himself, he's working with a, we have many colleagues coming from Pachuca. Pachuca is not far from us. And there's a student called Filiberto, who works with this. As you can see, this guy is coming too close. He shouldn't be there, but well. That's another hill. I don't know the name of that hill. Okay, so far for that. Just remember that for some reasons, it takes long time to make it work with this RTK. Now, perhaps finally, okay, if you want to see something funny, let me show you. Let's see. Pedro is working in Compiègne. He's a senior researcher, used to be my PhD student. Let's see what he can show us. I should tell you that he's not using the cameras around neither. So there's the looping. This is an autonomous looping. He's following some trajectories. Maybe this is two. Don't ask me what is the use of this. I don't know. Well, at least that's keeping him very busy. That's one thing. Ah! It's outside. We have a court. As you can see, we're not allowed to fly outside. And this court is all covered. So we're able to fly there, but not outside. Pedro Castillo and friends. Let's see. Show you. said, mentioned this simulation experiments. Israel is, there is some, he has some theory, he has not yet finished his PhD. And he's working on a small plane, so he had some, what is this? So we also have people working on airplanes. I hope. Well, he developed just this all this simulation thing. There, you have a video down here. Not, there you have a plane. As you can see, it's starting, and it's going to follow a trajectory autonomously. The takeoff is manual, but afterwards, it will follow some points. And that's a camera on board the little airplane. He developed a theory to track a trajectory, and he has published a few papers on conferences. Nothing on a journal yet. He has not yet finished his PhD, and this is done on a hobby. Hobby place, hobby terrain, close to Compiègne. There's wind, as you can see, and the plane is following the points that Israel has previously given to the system. He has developed all this simulation arrangement. The ground station, and that's and maybe it's landing now somewhere. I don't think the landing is autonomous. Actually, there is another student precisely working on autonomous takeoff and an autonomous landing. But yeah, we have not yet performed autonomous landing. It is more difficult to land autonomously than to fly autonomously. In the air, you can make mistakes. There'll be no problem. But once you're very close to the ground, then you're in trouble. What else could I? Or perhaps let's see. This is the work of Octavio. He's now working in Monterey somewhere. One of the several, he works on this vertical thing. I mean, this is VTOL, and we try to make the transition. He made a tricky transition. It's not so well done. But he tried several configurations. This was a long time ago. Today, I think there are better things. I'm just showing you. This was done perhaps 8 years ago or so. And he's now working somewhere in La Autónoma de Nuevo León in Monterrey. There are more people, but. Well, Alfredo, with Alfredo, I can show you some theory, but there's not much time. I better show you. He worked on formation, leader following. We wrote a book on this. I'm sorry. So this is what you can do. I mean, this is we're using here all the information coming from the cameras, so it's easier. Okay. But actually, I think there's one that try to do this. I mean, that perform something like this. Unfortunately, I mean, we also did some theory, but in this field. Formation control for drones. There's a lot of great papers being written. I mean, and it's hard to publish. So we're not so much working on this area. We used to work some time ago, and actually we even wrote a little book. Maybe I should leave some time for questions. Thank you.